Colleagues, I could just remind you of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face masks should be worn while moving around the chamber and around the wider Holyrood campus. Stephen Kerr.
Presiding officer, I wish to seek your guidance on a matter. It's regarding a question raised with the First Minister by Christine Graham. In that question, the member said that the UK had the worst state pension in Europe. Deputy Presiding Officer, it's important, I think, to set the record straight because facts do matter in this chamber. The fact is that the United Kingdom has a higher pension as a proportion of income maintained after retirement than Sweden, Norway, Latvia, Germany, Switzerland, Ireland, Estonia and Lithuania. Perhaps, Deputy Presiding Officer, you might advise me on how I might correct the record and what training is available for members so that they can avail themselves of this data on the OECD website so that such mistakes are not made again.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. As members will be aware, there is a mechanism that can be used to correct any contributions that are made in the chamber. Guidance on those mechanisms can be provided, but I think Mr Kerr has made his point. And with that, we will move on to portfolio questions. And the portfolio this afternoon is Rural Affairs and Islands. Anybody who wishes to ask a supplementary, if they could press the request to speak button to place an R in the chat function during the relevant question. Question number one has been withdrawn. Question number two, Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it currently provides to regional food groups.
Cabinet Secretary.
We support the groups through a £250,000 annual fund delivered by Scotland Food and Drink, which allows groups across the country to resource coordinator posts within each group. The fund leverages match funding from partners, including local authorities, and it allows for the establishment of an active network of regional ambassadors who work in conjunction with local authorities to promote regional food and drink and tourism strategies. And this support has ensured that we have 19 regional food groups operating collaboratively within their regions and collectively in partnership across Scotland.
Siobhan Brown.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. As the Cabinet Secretary is aware, Esha Food and all that in my constituency aims to identify and promote new opportunities for food and drink in Ayrshire, including in areas of activities such as local procurement, education and skills and training. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my view that organisations such as this are vital to continuing the good work that Scotland has accomplished in our cultural approach to food as we strive towards our ambition of being a good food nation?
I absolutely do, and it's really clear to me that the regional food groups have an absolutely pivotal role to play in telling Scotland's fantastic food and drink stories, and they're also going to be fundamental to the delivery of the next phase of Ambition 2030 at both a local and a national level too. And I think the work that the member has outlined in relation to food and all that is exactly the kind of approach that we want to see and the kind of approach that we want to encourage, and because it's that kind of work that they're undertaking in relation to all the issues that the member talked about, whether that's education, whether that's procurement, that is going to help us build the good food nation and become the good food nation that we want to be. And I also envisage that the groups playing a key role as we look to develop national and local good food nation plans as part of the Good Food Nation Scotland Bill. And these groups will also be really vital partners as we develop our local food strategy, which has been based on our recent consultation.
Okay. Brief supplementary from Rhoda Grant, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Being a good food nation means that people should have adequate access to food as well. This week I heard of a really sad case where an elderly person ended up in hospital due to starvation, not because they didn't have food, but they didn't have the electricity to cook it on. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what support she's giving to groups who are trying to help people in that situation, both to access food and the means to cook it?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member raises a really important question there, and some of this was teased out in the debate that we had earlier this week in stage one of the Good Food Nation Bill, because ensuring people that people do have the right to adequate food, that's a right in itself that we will be enshrining and incorporating into Scots law as part of a human rights bill. But it is something that we are trying to give effect to at the moment through the work that we're undertaking and through the Good Food Nation Bill itself, which provides the legal framework and underpinning for that. But we're always looking at ways that we can try and support people. I completely understand the issues that the member has raised, and it's something, and it's a situation that I think we will unfortunately see increasingly often, given the number of people that are currently in fuel poverty at the moment and will continue to be in that situation. It is only set to get worse. But together, the Scottish Government are trying to do all we can to address these issues where that's within our capabilities to do so.
Question number three, Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, to ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to help farmers make improvements to their farms, and can I refer members to my register of interest regarding agriculture?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government supports farmers and crofters to make improvements through a range of measures. These include the Sustainable Agricultural Capital Grant Scheme and access to specialist advice and information through our Farm Advisory Services. I can also announce today that we will be running a further round of the Knowledge Transfer and Innovation Fund in 2022-23, with £1.6 million available to support projects which enable more sustainable and low-carbon farming and crofting. TATIF has a significant track record in supporting projects which enable farmers, crofters and land managers to create improved opportunities for nature, adapt to climate change and benefit from new organic farming materials. We've helped to fund some really exciting projects over the last few years through this fund, and I would hope that people will apply for a share of this year's fund to play their part in tackling climate change.
Alexander Burnett.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? Now, there are reports that Lorna Slater would not be prepared to convert wild land into farms. Now, rewilding is important, but this government must be ready to adapt in the face of rising food prices and shortages. So does the Cabinet Secretary think a dogmatic, inflexible approach from the Greens could actually hold back support for our farmers in response to the crisis in Ukraine?
Cabinet Secretary.
I know I have a question on this matter from the member's colleague later on, but in relation to some of the requests that have been made in that regard, first of all, I would just want to reiterate the Scottish Government's commitment to supporting our farmers, our crofters and our food producers. That's been a core part of the vision that we outlined and which we published earlier this month, and it's something we have committed to continue to do. And I think especially given the really horrendous war that we're watching and all the acts that we're watching unfold in the Ukraine, I think it really highlights just how important and how vital our food security is. And that's why we recently also established a task force to help us address some of these issues and to address some of the immediate matters that we're facing, but also to look to what we can do to tackle these over the medium and longer term.
Brief supplementaries. Firstly, Tim Fairley.
Thank you, President Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my dismay at the Tories' failure to deliver on their Brexit promise to at least maintain current rural funding, and instead they are now shortchanging Scotland to the tune of £93 million during this Parliament? Funding which, of course, could have been provided to farmers to help them mitigate and address and adapt to climate change.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I absolutely do share the member's dismay in that regard, because the Scottish Government has been clear and consistent that we expect, because it's what we were promised, that full replacement of EU funds to ensure that there isn't any detriment to Scotland's finances. And we would expect the UK Government to fully respect the devolution settlement in any future arrangement, and this so far hasn't happened. And I know that my colleagues and my fellow administrations in Wales and Northern Ireland also share our frustration in that regard. Now, there was also a BEW review commitment to hold meaningful discussions to agree the principles of future intra-UK allocations. That should have occurred before the UK spending review, but however, we're still waiting on the UK Government and George Eustace to meet this commitment.
And Mercedes Villalba.
Thank you. In response to my colleague Martin Whitfield back in September, the Cabinet Secretary said that food should be processed as close as possible to the point of primary production. She also committed the Scottish Government to working with any operators looking to take forward a mobile abattoir model. Given that 6 months have passed, can the Cabinet Secretary update the Chamber on what steps she is taking to improve abattoir provision and whether the Scottish Government will take forward the mobile abattoir model if no prospective operators come forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
First of all, in response to that, my previous commitment still stands and we still stand ready to work with anybody who is interested in looking at this as a model to go forward. And I would also stand by the first part of the member's question as well in relation to trying to ensure as far as we possibly can that food is processed as locally as possible. Now, all of these are issues which we were considering through our draft local food strategy, which was out to consultation and which closed towards the end of last year. So we're currently still analysing the responses of that consultation and we'll be setting out our responses to that in due course.
Thank you. Question number four, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the Steerwatch Annual Report 2021 from Onekind.
Minister Mary McCann.
Presiding Officer, I am aware of the report's findings and I understand the concerns around the use of snares. We have recently concluded a review of snaring in terms of the Wildlife and Countryside Act, and we will publish this very shortly. However, I have also commissioned an additional review which will look beyond the terms of the Act and will consider a potential ban on snaring. It will look at the land management aspects of it as well as animal welfare. But in the meantime, Scotland has the most robust laws with regards to snaring in the UK. We remain committed to the highest possible animal welfare standards.
Ruth Maguire.
Thank the Minister for that very full answer. Ending cruelty against animals is something that's very important to myself and to my constituents. With that in mind, can the Minister say a little bit more about the second review that she's commissioned?
Minister.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Yes, happy to. I have said that while that initial statutory review is now complete, and I'll be pleased to share the details of it shortly, I have commissioned that further review and will look beyond the terms, including considering a ban. And I hope to announce the details of this very shortly. I know how strongly the member and how strongly the public feel about this. And I'm clear that we need control measures, but what we cannot and must not tolerate is suffering. And I'll look to include that in the terms of the review.
Thank you. Question number five, Russell Findlay. To
ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with scientists regarding gene editing of crops.
Minister Manny McCann.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Scottish Government ministers and officials speak regularly with scientists on a range of issues, including gene editing, and we have access to a wealth of scientific expertise, including from the Chief Scientific Advisor for Environment, Natural Resources and Agriculture, the Chief Plant Health Officer, and research and evidence provided by centres of expertise, such as the Plant Health Centre.
Russell Findlay.
Thank you for that answer. My colleague Rachel Hamilton recently met with the Roslin Institute and they once again reaffirmed their support for gene editing to get the green light in Scotland. Why is the Scottish Government continuing to fail to support Scotland's top scientists on this?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, there are a range of views on this matter which I'm following very closely. I've greatly welcomed scientific opinion on this. However, our policy on GM has not changed. Russell Findlay and his Tory colleagues might be prepared to hurriedly change environmental standards post-Brexit, but this government isn't. We'll take a considered approach, and I'm closely following progress at EU level in that regard.
Thank you. And a couple of supplementaries. First, Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise whether the Tory UK government has shared or provided any cumulative impact assessment from the two trade deals which it has negotiated since Brexit, which by its own admission fall in UK and Scottish agriculture?
Minister, that's not relevant to gene editing. I don't think there's anything that you can add, unless you advise me otherwise, that would relate back to the original question.
Except perhaps in regard to advice received, Presiding Officer, but I'll take your views on the matter and won't answer the question.
And briefly, Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. At our last rural questions, the Cabinet Secretary was clearly confused between GMOs and gene editing. Now it appears that the Minister is equally as confused. Will the Minister please take the time to understand the difference between GMOs and gene editing? Scotland's farmers can see potential benefits in gene editing. Why can't the Scottish Government?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, the member needn't try to patronise or belittle me or outsmart me, because he will not succeed. I am following very closely both scientific and judicial reasoning about the decoupling of GM and gene editing, the latter being a process which is considered that could also have resulted in the same processes occurring naturally, if not through the gene editing process. But as I've said to his colleague, our position has not changed, and I'm following the EU in this regard.
Okay, question number six, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government what measures it's putting in place to attract younger people into the farming sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
We recognise that getting young people into the sector is key to driving our rural economy forward, and we know that younger people face a number of obstacles getting into the sector which can be off-putting. And that's why this Government is continuing to support them by developing skills and talent through our Skills Action Plan for Rural Scotland and through the Skills for Farming Group to guide employers on apprenticeships and work placements. Additional support will continue to be provided by our Farming Opportunities for New Entrants Group, the Scottish Land Matching Service and Farm Advisory Service.
Liz Smith.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for her acknowledgement that there is a problem, because I've certainly been contacted by several younger constituents across Mid Scotland and Fife recently that they feel that they are struggling to get into the farming sector, and that's an issue that's been highlighted at some of the NFUS meetings on a local basis, and that includes the recent Scottish Government statistics which show that since 2016 the Scottish Government's Opportunities for New Entrants programme has helped only 76 young entrants to get into farming. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that that is a disappointingly low number and that a new strategy is required to address this?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, we want to say that we do have a manifesto commitment that we would look at this, and that's where I welcome the evaluation that has recently been published, because I think, well, I was pleased to read in that the grants were successful in encouraging 254 new younger entrants into the sector, and that we granted over £11.6 million to allow that to happen. But as the member highlights, the review highlighted that there are challenges as well relating to land availability and the profitability of agricultural businesses, and that still remained, that there still remain those considerable barriers to new entrants which grants alone won't be able to address. But as I've just previously intimated, we will be using the outcomes of that review to help shape the future plans for new entrant support in line with our manifesto commitment.
And a couple of supplementaries as brief as possible. First, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise Parliament about the SkillSeeder programme, what it does and how it is being funded?
And as briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
As possible, Presiding Officer, but the SkillSeeder company are delivering a really easy, accessible rural land-based training and SkillSeeder IT platform, and ultimately what that aims to do is to break down the barriers for people throughout rural Scotland and make it easier for people to find the right training for them and for skill sharers and trainers to easily reach people who need their training. And there are currently 5,000 courses on there already, including from colleges, machinery rings, renewable companies and forestry, and we'd recently announced some funding in relation to that, so I would encourage people that if they're interested in undertaking that training to seek out those opportunities.
Thank you. And Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding.
Sorry, Audrey Nicholl, I'm looking at the wrong paper, sorry.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While I appreciate Liz Smith's original questions related to the farming sector, similarly the fishing and seafood industries are also working hard to attract young people to their sectors. This includes fish processors in my constituency working with Seafish and the Seafood Association through campaigns such as See a Bright Future. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary for an update on the work being done to support young people moving into the fishing and processing sectors?
I do like to keep you on your toes, but Cabinet Secretary.
This is also an area where we're keen to see new entrants, and the Marine Fund Scotland has supported new entrants to secure their positions in the fishing industry. So, for example, we've been assisting young fishers to purchase their first fishing boat or to have a share in a fishing boat. And to date, so far, we've awarded around £2 million of funding to assist entry of young fishers to the sector. And the fund has also supported new entrants by providing grant support to Seafish to deliver training in Scotland.
Thank you. Question number seven, Annabel Ewing.
To ask the Scottish Government when it will implement the findings of the first stage of the review on licensing in the aquaculture sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
The review undertaken by Professor Griggs is comprehensive, it's ambitious, and it fulfils the remit that was given to him. And I just want to take this opportunity to thank Professor Russell Griggs again for his work and all the effort that he put into producing this piece of work. Now, I've already made clear my agreement to all the recommendations in principle, and I will announce shortly the next steps that will take us beyond this first phase. And I think it is really vital that we maintain that momentum and approach our commitment to streamline the regulatory process for aquaculture with pace.
Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response, and I am indeed pleased to hear that there is an intention to proceed speedily. But the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that some 600 jobs in Rosyth in my constituency depend on the success of the salmon industry. So I would therefore ask the Cabinet Secretary to take the opportunity to confirm today that she will now instruct her officials to work at pace to implement the Griggs Review recommendations, because that will ensure a better, more efficient and transparent aquacultural regulatory framework, which is essential for future sustainability and competitiveness. And can the Cabinet Secretary also take the opportunity today to confirm that she will work constructively with industry to get this right?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, that's certainly my intention. And aquaculture is hugely important to Scotland's economy. And I absolutely recognise Rosyth as one of the communities that depend on the success of a sustainable aquaculture industry. Now, as I've mentioned, we are determined to make sure that we continue with that momentum and with that pace in progressing work that takes us beyond the first phase of this review. And we are committed to that collaborative working. And we'll continue to engage with stakeholders into phase two of the aquaculture review and for the production and in the production of a government-led vision for aquaculture. Now, we'd also would just want to mention that as part of our manifesto commitments, we said that we would reform and streamline regulatory processes so that development is more responsive, transparent and efficient. And to achieve that, we're also committed through our manifesto commitments to implement a process that will bring greater clarity and speed to the process of aquaculture regulation. And we appointed Professor Griggs as part of that 100-day commitment, and we're now finalising the next steps into phase two of the work required to move beyond the status quo.
And supplementary, Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The mortality rate of Scottish salmon farms is 24%, and that was in 2020. Environmental sustainability depends on the robust enforcement of compliance, and we know that SEPA and NatureScot have recently suffered successive budget cuts. So, Cabinet Secretary, with any new licence fee, will it be used to pay for greatly expanded independent monitoring of fish farms' impacts, especially including sea lice counts and fish deaths?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we'd say that, I mean, the work that has just been announced, we're obviously, as I've just said in my previous response there, to continue that momentum and to build on the work that's already been announced. It would be premature for me to make any specific commitments in relation to what the member's talking about, given the phase that we're at with that work. But I would also just want to point out too that as part of the Bute House Agreement, we recognised that there was an immediate programme of work that needed to be carried out in that regard. And I would also just highlight to the member and to those across the chamber that that was also why we set out our response to the Salmon Interactions Working Group to try and tackle some of the issues that already exist while we were undertaking this review.
Thank you. And question number 8, Sue Webber, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it is adapting its agricultural policy for crops and livestock due to the war in Ukraine.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government recognises the impact that the terrible war in Ukraine is having on global agri-food markets. And on the 17th of March, we announced the establishment of a short-life food security and supply task force jointly with industry leaders to monitor, identify and respond to any potential disruption to the food and drink supply chain. Now, it will also seek to recommend actions that can be taken to mitigate impacts, resolve supply issues and strengthen food security and supply in Scotland, where we remain committed to producing more of our own food sustainably while maintaining and enhancing nature.
Sue Webber.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. Yes, the war in Ukraine has highlighted the need to support our farmers and growers to help deal with crises like this, inflationary pressures and the market volatility that they're facing. So will the Cabinet Secretary also promise that her government will not approve any more deals to send thousands of seed potatoes to Russia?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think there's a few points that need to be clarified in relation to this. So, the Scottish Government does not approve export deals. Now, we've led calls for businesses to disinvest in Russia as a result of the invasion of Ukraine,
and we've communicated that very clearly to the seed potato suppliers concerned. The Scottish Government and its economic agencies will use all available powers not to support trade and investment activity within Russia. And where a company makes the decision to export any plants or other plant products from Scotland, including seed potatoes, Scottish Government officials are required to carry out various activities in relation to this, including the inspection and the certification of goods. But again, the Scottish Government does not approve export deals.
A couple of supplementaries. Firstly, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The terrible conflict in Ukraine, as has been said earlier, will impact on food security in Scotland, as was highlighted in Tuesday's Good Food Nation Bill debate. So could the Cabinet Secretary inform us how the UK Government is involving the Scottish Government and the other devolved administrations in discussions and deliberations in this area?
Cabinet Secretary.
Right across the Scottish Government, we are in contact with the UK Government on a range of aspects in relating to the conflict and the impacts as a result of that. And I know that the First Minister attends a weekly domestic resilience meeting chaired by the Minister for the Cabinet Office. And Ukraine has been also one of the top agenda items at the regular interministerial group meetings that we have with DEFRA and with other devolved administrations too. However, I'm also continuing to press for further engagement with DEFRA Minister Victoria Prentice to ensure that we are closely involved in responding to this fast-moving situation, and that includes most recently at the last interministerial group meeting, which took place at the start of this week. Now, at that meeting, Victoria Prentice assured all the relevant devolved ministers that there would be that ongoing close contact and liaison, given that many of the issues impacted by the Russian invasion of Ukraine are devolved and are shared right across the UK. So I'm obviously keen to ensure that that commitment is followed through, and will be doing what I can to ensure that it is.
And Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wish the Cabinet Secretary well in getting that engagement, because she'll know there are many Ukrainian seasonal workers carrying out outstanding work at the moment supporting Scottish agriculture and fruit growing. And although their visas have been extended until December, they're only valid as long as workers stay on their current farm or are placed by their sponsor on another farm. But those workers can't apply for their families to join them, and are generally subject to no recourse to public funds. So would the Cabinet Secretary consider what more support the Scottish Government could give those farm workers, and indeed help more come to Scotland from Ukraine, including how they may be able to bring their family over, have access to public funds and services, given the enormous contribution they're all making to Scottish farm and fruit pickers at the moment?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, absolutely. We're committed to doing that, and are doing all that we can to ensure that we're giving that support where possible. And I just want to provide the assurance to the member and across chamber that we're engaging closely with our fruit and vegetable producers on a regular basis. And we're aware that, of course, there are some workers from Ukraine already here, and the plan was for many more to join them as part of the seasonal workforce, and clearly that's unlikely to happen. But we're working urgently with all of our stakeholders and internally to determine how best we can support these workers, that includes to ensure that they're aware of and are known to parts of government which are coordinating our action to support Ukrainian refugees. And also, just in addition to that, we've also reached out to RSABI with a view to utilise their already established seasonal worker helpline, and are working closely with them to find out what and how they can provide assistance. Because clearly we want to be able to provide all possible practical and emotional support that we can, and we will certainly be doing everything we can within the powers and resources that we have to provide that.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions. Can I extend an apology again to Audrey Nicholl and Evelyn Tweed for the confusion? Can I also remind members that for portfolio questions, if you have a question or you intend to ask a supplementary, you need to be here at the beginning of portfolio questions and remain until the end of portfolio questions. I'm not going to name and shame on this occasion, but let it be noted. There will be a slight pause before we move to the next item of business.